Hi, I'm Priscila and I am a scientific content writer at Izon Science. In this video, I will briefly go through tips and practical suggestions to isolate EVs from blood. Blood is a resourceful biofluid for EV research. As blood EVs come from different cellular origins, representing multitude of physiological states. Blood is one of the most used liquid biopsies, as it's minimally invasive for the subject. However, blood is a complex matrix that can have substantial pre-analytical variability. This is due in large part to the fact that blood cells, particularly platelets, can be activated easily and release EVs during the sample collection and processing. One limitation about working with blood sample is the amount of biofluid obtained from one donor, as blood collection tubes hold a maximum of 10 mL, and 50% of blood corresponds to plasma or serum. Another limitation can be that blood collection requires a phlebotomist, a person certified to withdraw blood. However, specialized lab facilities are not necessary. Therefore, a few considerations are necessary to preserve the physiological status of different blood-derived EVs and minimize their artificial modifications. In this workflow, the process starts when blood sample is retrieved from test subject. Then, plasma or serum is obtained from the blood by removing cellular components, leading to a light yellow clear liquid sample. An optional but commonly used storage step follows, which helps to maintain the integrity and biology of the EVs until full isolation protocol can be continued. After an appropriate EV purification step, such as size exclusion chromatography QEV columns, an optional post-concentration step can follow to finally yield a pure EV-enriched preparation. The first consideration is how much blood volume will I need? As mentioned before, half the volume of blood corresponds to plasma or serum. Therefore, for every 10 mL of blood, 5 mL of plasma or serum will be obtained. In general, depending on the EV isolation method, there is approximately 1 or 2 times 10 to the 9 EVs per mL of plasma or serum. Another important distinction is the sample of interest, which can be plasma or serum. Mainly, plasma is the cell-free liquid portion of blood when clotting is prevented, and serum is the cell-free liquid portion of blood when clotting is allowed. How is coagulation prevented? With the presence of anticoagulants in the blood collection tube, used to withdraw the blood. There are more than 10 different blood collection tubes available in the market to choose from, containing different anticoagulants or other components, and most of the times are color-coded for easy visualization. The choice of anticoagulant in the tube may have significant effects in the downstream analysis, as for example, heparin or EDTA residues may interfere, for example, with PCR reactions. How long can blood stay in the tube? Studies have shown that EVs significantly increase within 3 hours of unprocessed blood samples. Therefore, it is recommended to process blood under 1 hour, as well as to minimize agitation during the transport of the blood sample. Like other EV-containing samples, cells must be gently removed by centrifugation at 200 G for 20 minutes. At this stage, it is important to have no breaks in the centrifugation step to avoid damage of the cells. Platelets are the smallest of blood cells. They have functions on the clotting process, and they must be removed with slightly higher speed centrifugations. Thus, once blood is in the appropriate tube, a portion of the platelets can be eliminated with gentle centrifugation at 400 G for 15 minutes at room temperature, resulting in a sample called platelet-rich plasma. Next, platelet-poor plasma can be obtained by centrifuging sample at 1550 G for 20 minutes at room temperature. Finally, platelet-free plasma can be obtained by 2 spins at 2500 G for 15 minutes at room temperature. The importance of platelet removal lies on the fact that platelets normally activate by injury signals from blood vessels in the body, but they can also activate by shear or cold. Upon activation, platelets generate significant amount of EVs. Therefore, it is critical to avoid exposure of platelets in the plasma serum sample to cold temperature and remove them as quickly as possible. before they artificially populate the sample with their EVs during the handling process. As mentioned before, ideally samples should be freshly obtained and immediately processed to achieve maximal EV recovery and stability. However, most of the time, full EV purification is not feasible after plasma serum samples are obtained, requiring some storage. The two variables investigated to maintain EV stability have been storage temperature and time. Some studies have helped determining effects on specific EV populations, such as nano-EVs and micro-EVs. However, there's still some debate. Data shows that plasma stored at minus 20 or minus 80 degrees maintains nano-EV numbers for months and years of storage, as opposed to storage of plasma at room temperature or 4 degrees, in which nano-EVs increase through time, most likely due to artificial generation of EVs from residual platelets. In the same way, studies performed in micro-EVs have shown that storage at minus 80 increase EV numbers in platelet-poor plasma, possibly due to platelet activation and release of micro-EVs. The first step into EV isolation is the optional separation of micro-EVs by centrifuging plasma serum sample at 10,000 G or 20,000 G for 30 minutes to pellet micro-EVs and resuspending them in desired buffer volume. The supernatant is then ready for purification by size exclusion chromatography, QEV columns. There are two types of resins in QEV columns. One has a pore size of 35 nanometers and isolation particle range of 35 to 350 nanometers, and the other one has a pore size of 70 nanometers and an isolation particle range of 70 to 1000 nanometers. The particle size range in these columns overlap, but they also emphasize in the isolation of EVs in two big groups, exosomes and microvesicles. There are different QEV columns suitable for different sample input volumes. However, the preferred QEV among researchers for plasma samples are QEV2s, since they seem to match the plasma or serum volumes obtained from one person's blood sample. QEV columns can be run with automatic fraction collector, AFC, with automated flushing and collection of fractions and customizable settings, like buffer volume and amount and volume of each fraction. The AFC allows standardization and reproducibility for EV purification process. Here's an example of fraction profiling with a QEV2, where particle counts are shown in bars and proteins in lines. There are three or four EV-rich fractions which are separate from the most of the proteins present in the plasma serum. After the QEV run, EV-rich fractions can be pulled and used as such, or can be further concentrated for any downstream applications that require highly enriched EV samples in small volumes. For this post-concentration step, most common method seems to be ultrafiltration. Ultrafiltration allows a separation of EVs by size by passing the sample through a filter with protein-based pore sizes, for example, 10, 100, or 300 kilodaltons. Everything larger than that pore size is retained, basically all EVs, while most proteins pass through. However, there's also a new product launched by Izon, which enables concentration of EVs after purification with QEV column. This QEV concentration kit is based on polymer particles which bind to EVs with high affinity, enabling pelleting the whole complex without the need of ultracentrifugation speeds, which might damage the integrity of EVs. Finally, sample characterization can be performed with EV count, size, and charge assessment by TRPS. Molecular profiling can be done by quantification of DNA, RNA, and proteins present in EVs. Presence of population-specific EV markers can be done by Western blot assays or visualization done by microscopy techniques. Thank you for watching, and please visit izon.com for application notes and guides to help you work with different types of nanoparticle samples.